Mr. President, Mr. Secretary General, dear students, distinguished panelists, of course, I will repeat the same formula, but I'm very pleased to see so many of you here at this OSCE seminar, talk seminar, which is quite unusual in our OSCE practice, and this is the second of the series. It is a new initiative by OSCE, which brings leading experts, students, journalists, and others together to explore current issues. We trust you will learn and benefit from the talks as well as we. We also want to hear your ideas. We are open to the views of experts, bright students, NGOs, and the public. That is a part of the transparency that OSCE promotes in open public discourse. The Lithuanian Championship has almost reached the famous 100 days milestone. In the course of this time, I have traveled to New York, Washington, Moscow, Brussels, and many other cities to discuss and begin implementing our program for 2011. I have visited some of the most complicated regions where protracted conflicts have stubbornly defied the resolution, Moldova and the South Caucasus. In addition, I traveled to Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Armenia, Azerbaijan, and Georgia to meet government leaders, NGOs, minority representatives, and media representatives, among others. My Vice Minister and Secretary General Dobrychambeau have been to Albania to work with our EU and United States partners to calm the political situation there. In my travels throughout the OSCE region, I have participated in some 120 official meetings and diplomatic discussions, and of course, have been to Vienna to present the chair's views to the Permanent Council. In these 3 months and throughout my travels, one salient point has been clear at every stop. Euro-Atlantic security and Eurasian security must be viewed as indivisible and include all three dimensions of society. This reality has evolved steadily over the years since the adoption of the Helsinki Final Act. But for years, let us be honest, there has been an underlying sense that the OSCE area is divided between east of Vienna and west of Vienna. Since the Astana summit in December 2010, at the latest, however, we have committed ourselves to establishing a single security community across the entire Eurasian and Euro-Atlantic space, indivisible, interlinked throughout all dimensions of the OSCE, security, economic and environment, and in the human dimension. In the OSCE, security is bound up in our respect for the dignity of each individual and the acceptance of differences in our diverse and rich cultures. Our communities are safest when human rights, fundamental freedoms, and the rule of law are upheld. When those rights and freedoms are violated, we are all at risk. During my visit to Kyrgyzstan and Osh province, where hundreds of lives were lost last year, it was evident that the respect for the rights of the ethnic communities is necessary for the security, not only of the people directly concerned, but for the society at large, as well as the state. And in the case of a tragedy in Osh province, this affected neighboring Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan as well. The role of OSCE in these circumstances is to restore trust between communities and ensure the stability and the respect for the rights is restored and preserved. We, as the chairmanship, is acting to promote the Community Security Initiative as a practical process to begin rebuilding confidence between the communities. Ladies and gentlemen, another guarantee for our security is found in the freedom to express ourselves, not just in words, but in actions. In this regard, we must always try to preserve and improve our individual electoral processes. We must guarantee free assembly and equal and free access to the media. I am concerned with the current tendencies in Moscow and Baku. We must ensure the freedom to speak out without fear of injury, imprisonment, or even death. These are guarantees which must be preserved and improved throughout our OSCE area with no regard to East or West. Some of the greatest threats to us as individuals, as well as collectively, are transnational in nature. These include terrorism and international criminal activities, including the trafficking of people, weapons, and drugs. Looking ahead, I will be traveling in May to Afghanistan, Turkmenistan, and Tajikistan. There I will promote greater coordination, communication, and cooperation in the region to establish more effective border management to combat the threats coming out of Afghanistan. The Lithuanian Chairmanship has chosen to begin the post-Astana process of building this inclusive security community by addressing several specific challenges identified at Astana. These include, among others, protracted conflicts over borders and territory, transnational threats. Their cooperation and openness among the participating states is essential if we are to find solutions. Energy security, which given the recent catastrophe in Japan, includes nuclear security. Cybersecurity, where the issues over rich borders, where balance must be obtained between freedom of access to information and responsibility in its use. Human rights security, personal, media, institutional, civil society. By the 6th and 7th of December, I look to participating states to reach firm conclusions in all of these areas at the Vilnius Ministerial. Much of the work the chairmanship has focused on during its first 100 days has evolved these very things. Immediately, the situation in Belarus comes to mind. As time passes, I see Belarus tending to go more and more into self-isolation. This affects not just the leadership, but also the people. As a neighbor watching this, it hurts. We ask again and again that Belarus reconsider. It refuses. It is regrettable that the authorities there continue to refuse the presence of the OSCE in Minsk. But as a chairman, I will continue to support efforts to protect human rights in Belarus. I will encourage the work of NGOs inside and outside the country and ensure through the use of ODIHR observers that trials are properly monitored. As a chair, I have devoted a great deal of time and energy on the protracted conflicts in Moldova, Nagorno-Karabakh, and in the South Caucasus. This is a long and complex process. With the co-chairs of the Minsk group, we need to focus on concrete confidence-building steps, such as the removal of snipers from along the contact line in Nagorno-Karabakh. It requires overcoming years of negative historical experience and suspicions. It is normal to encounter resistance to change, particularly when it threatens the status quo power structures. When you are in the middle of a process, it seems to be going nowhere. We know from experience, however, that to build our common security community, it is necessary to develop practical processes and apply concrete measures. It is encouraging when working on disputes like the prolonged conflicts, which seem to defy solution, to recall some of the OSCE success stories. Croatia and Serbia come immediately to mind. Two countries, two ethnic groups, only recently at war, now progressing side by side towards stable societies based on democratic rule of law structures and principles. We also need to remind ourselves of the significant progress made throughout the OSCE participating states on the issues such as media freedom, gender equality, NGO development, cooperation on improvement border management, fighting international crime, and many other so-called soft security issues. There are times and events, however, which catch us up short and remind us what we do not have limitless time to deal with the problems. They remind us of the need to take more decisive action. Events in North Africa, Middle East, and Japan are such a case. As an experienced partner, OSCE has an obligation to offer advice and to share our best practices as they are appropriate. Coordinated efforts under the United Nations umbrella, which I discussed with United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, is the most effective approach to coordinating assistance. The OSCE has a role to play. In 10 days, I and a representative from ODIHR will travel to Tunis to explore ways the OSCE can support our partner. The OSCE can offer practical experience in institution building and managing electoral processes in a society in transition, society in transition. The natural catastrophe in Japan also reminds us of a continual need for our participating states to share best practices on crisis management and to work to apply the highest standards for nuclear safety throughout the OSCE region. Ladies and gentlemen, the building our common security community is a task which will go well beyond this chairmanship. We are building on the commitments reconfirmed at Astana. I expect to document concrete achievements at the Vilnius Ministerial in December. We look to see the work we have begun to be continued and developed further by succeeding chairmanship.
Thank you very much, Mr. Director, Mr. President, Mr. Minister, my chairman in office. It's really a great pleasure to be back here and to participate in these OSCE talk seminar. I think one of the hallmarks that you have mentioned, Minister, of the work of the Lithuanian chairmanship is its outreach, its attempt to work with academic circles, to be present in the intellectual debate, to draw on the expertise of outsiders, and therefore to have a very active second track activity in support of its chairmanship. I think this move has been very much welcome and supported by a number of participating states. This is one of its manifestations. There are others going on in Vienna, which I think will open up and contribute to the overall discussion. Mr. Director, I'm going to be very brief because I do not want to cover the tracks which the chairman in office has already led us through, and just give you a few very, very simple references. We have benefited since I came here for, I think, what was a major and very useful event in the life of the organization, which was the Astana Summit. First time in 11 years. We were not very fortunate in terms of visibility with the media because there were other major things going on the international scene at in early December, not least WikiLeaks, and all the expert journalists were busy tunneling their way through those cables and not paying enough attention to what was going on in Astana. But I think, as the minister hinted, Astana was a great success for the organization. It was very useful to have those 56 heads of state and government aware of the project that is OSCE, aware again of the underlying values and commitments that they shared, and willing to reactivate and very much recommit them in the commemorative delegation declaration of Astana, which is a strong and serious text, which I do recommend. We didn't manage quite to approve a framework for action, which was a 9-page text, even more substantial, very narrowly. But interestingly, when we came back to Vienna, we found out that all the key stakeholders in the organization considered that it remained a valid background, a very useful basis for further work. And of course, they rely very much now on the Lithuanian chairmanship, which, as you said, has achieved its 3rd month, a quarter of its course, and if I may say, the ascendant phase of its trajectory, getting things moving, getting things going, and already meeting its first crisis. You mentioned that, Minister, in the short time of the OSCE, because we have to live in the short time of the crisis which come, and in the very long time of what is the job of the OSCE, which is to sponsor the implementation of standards and commitments, and basically of successful democratic transitions throughout the whole of the OSCE region, and of course a little bit beyond. But in the short term, Lithuania has already been gratified by fate, if I may say. One major problem in Belarus, which unfortunately has led us to have to close our presence there, who had been doing a fantastic job. Rumblings ongoing around Nagorno-Karabakh, where the shooting goes on. Minister paid a visit. President Grybauskaitė will soon go to the area. The Caucasus front is still very much alive, both in Georgia and in Nagorno-Karabakh. Difficulties in Albania, and a constant worry about what is going to happen in southern Kyrgyzstan, which has a potential for ethnic conflict that could really remind us of the Balkans if it were to happen anyway. So the task of the chairmanship is to be on the spot, to be present, secretariat, field officers, institutions, very much involved. High Commissioner for National Minorities was speaking to both the minister and myself yesterday about his trip to Tashkent and to Osh, and paying a lot of attention to the problems in southern Kyrgyzstan. So it's very much a teamwork. We are all interacting very closely to address those issues. But of course, the long-time perspective of the OSCE is also there, and it is the work of the field officers. It is the work that is being deployed by the chair in animating the spirit of creating a security community in Vienna, and doing so in all dimensions, and those you care very much about, Minister, such as freedom of the media, protection of journalists, for which there will be very soon an important seminar, energy security issues, transport security. We are having right now a meeting very close to Vilnius, which I think is working very well. So all this in-depth work of deepening the understanding of the standards and commitments, refreshing the commitment of all the participating states, and moving forward in new projects. Never simple, because OSCE is a reflection of the greater family of Europe as it is, still quite contradictory and split, and having a hard time finding a common perspective on many things. The work of election monitoring, for instance, is also a mirror of those tensions. As you know, there were elections in Kazakhstan on Sunday. We had quite sharp comments from the ODIHR and Parliamentary Assembly observers there. Not sure the Kazakh authorities will be absolutely enchanted by those comments, but as a former chairmanship, they welcomed the presence of OSCE, and it was called upon to give its opinion. We also keeping an eye on Azerbaijan, which is and going through a delicate phase, and there will be more elections coming soon, certainly in Skopje, possibly also in Turkey, which will call for the attention of the organization. So in a way, election monitoring is the equivalent for the OSCE of what the European Courts of Human Rights is for the Council of Europe. It is the tool to gauge and encourage the state of implementation of the commitments and the need to move forward. And then, Minister, of course, you have mentioned the broadening of the picture. The fact that we have very much been in tune with the events in the southern Mediterranean Rim, which do remind, of course, certain elements of the events in the OSCE area in the early 90s, because the picture is the same. How to create a transition from constrained authoritarian societies to open democratic ones, but do so in all the dimensions which ensure the viability of stable societies and vibrant democracies. Clearly, if we are far from having finalized the process of transformation within the OSCE area, when we touch on those countries on in the Middle East and North Africa, we are entering into very difficult territory. OSCE can make a contribution. You will be exploring this in Tunisia, Minister, but it will not do so alone. It will do so clearly as part of a broader team of institutions, with UN, with European Union, with Council of Europe, with bilateral efforts of others. So the 9 months that remain, Minister, and the 8 months until the Vilnius ministerial are likely to be equally intense and demanding. I think we're very, very proud in Secretariat to be working with a very ambitious and proactive team here in Vilnius and in Vienna. There will be some institutional issues. May I be very candid, my term runs out on the 30th of June, and one of the concerns for the chairmanship is to find consensus on a new Secretary General. It's a matter of persons, but it's also a matter of politics, and creating consensus on such a sensitive issue is a very, very complicated process in the organization, and one which will certainly test all the diplomatic qualities, yours, Minister, and your teams. But I'm sure that you will be very, very successful in not only making the right choice, but bringing everybody on the right choice. So I wish you every success. I understand we are also here to have a debate and dialogue with all of you. So I stop at this point and I'm ready to contribute to any discussion. Thank you very much, Professor.
All distinguished present here, I definitely have a privilege to address all of you, people who are not only interested in international issues faced by our community, but at the same time, the experts. In March 2007, I addressed the OSCE in Vienna, and I believe at least one individual here who was present over there, and expounded upon the vision of the Europe whole, free and at peace with itself. In my remarks, I stressed that the vision, as attractive as it was, had not been yet been realized. How far we have been able to develop that idea of an all-encompassing, all-embarrassing security community, and how far have we come? How do we proceed today? In March of 2007, I also strongly advocated the idea that Lithuania should be given the privilege and challenge to serve as the chair in office. Lithuania, I contended, possessed unusual qualities which qualified it for the tasks it would face. Having regained its independence and re-established itself in a community of nations, Lithuania had transformed its system and its institutions, steps which in themselves contributed to a stronger European security community. Located literally at the center of Europe, Lithuania had become a member of the Western democratic system. It had a strong and determined independent tradition. It represented through its experience and success an example of the change that had occurred in Europe and could contribute to building a European security community whole and free. The principles behind the vision of a Europe whole and free and at peace with itself, was a community in which all participating OSCE states, regardless of size and geography, belong as fully equal members in a community which accepted the principles of a common security realm. And at the same time, this community could not maintain Cold War differentiation or division. Rather, it should incorporate the whole of the Euro-Atlantic and Eurasian security areas. The idea, obviously, inspired many leaders and a great many people of the East of us as the events of the Orange and Rose Revolution made clear. With great anticipation, we watched the demonstrations and the actions by those two peoples expressing their desire for transparent, democratic rule of law-based societies. Success in their endeavors would mean that the expansion of the concept and the reality of Euro-Atlantic security as a part of the developing free and whole Europe. When the dispute over the Ukrainian elections arose, I, together with OSCE Secretary General Jan Kubiš, EU representative Javier Solana, and Polish President Aleksander Kwasniewski mediated the situation. The OSCE and EU were decisive in their intervention based on the findings of ODHR to challenge widespread voter fraud, help prevent violence, and create the conditions for new and fair elections. I also had the opportunity to work with other democratic leaders to provide support and courage to the leaders of the Rose Revolution in Georgia. We promoted the fight against corruption, supported democratic institutions building, and worked through the OSCE special representatives for the media and Miklos Harasti to promote the development of a free and effective media. But in the end, things did not develop as we had hoped. Why? What went wrong? First and foremost, I believe as a personal opinion, we in the West, perhaps most of all in the EU, did not maintain sufficiently energetic support for the revolution's leaders to carry them through the different time difficulties of transition from former Soviet system to modern, transparent, rule of the law-based democracies. After the first flush of popular expressions of enthusiasm and support, Western leaders and institutions, and perhaps most of all the Western public, demonstrated sometimes subtle, sometimes startling, their reluctance to quickly draw Ukraine and Georgia into their midst. Perhaps it was due to the so-called enlargement fatigue. Certainly, it had to do with the fact that the two Eastern societies did not match many Western institutional and social standards with respect to democracy, international structures, and rule of law. It is my perception that at the critical moments, the leaders of the Orange and Rose Revolutions showed themselves to be somewhat unsure and untested. They appeared to look in vain for the guidance and the tools they needed. And that help met the critical challenges that lay in front of them, both internally and well as international. And I have to admit, I am still disappointed by the failure of the Orange and Rose revolutions. But I am not wholly discouraged. A good idea, a grand vision, whose time has come, will persist. I believe that this is still possible if under altered circumstances. The concept of the common security community, to which all the OSCE participating states committed themselves at Astana, reaffirms the vision of Europe, whole and free, within a broad, consensual level of support, which was not so explicitly evident in earlier days. And I would say that the vision is alive. But I am concerned that a high great and goals proclaimed at Astana might be understood and undercut by old practices. The threat of force and the use of force continue to lurk in the background, particularly in the sensitive South Caucasus region. I question the wisdom, particularly, of introducing modern Mistral naval craft into the area. I am concerned that neither side is preparing to withdraw snipers from the contact line in Nagorno-Karabakh, despite the wise and persistent urging of mediators and the chairman in office. I witnessed the blunt violations of human rights in Belarus and in the Osh district of Kyrgyzstan, and I ask where the Astana commitment is. And at the same time, I am encouraged that it is Lithuania, through its chairmanship, which has taken up several main teams from the Astana and conference, is working deliberately to promote reform and change in Belarus, and by encouraging mediation and active negotiations in the area of protracted conflicts. I am encouraged and pleased that it is Lithuania's chairmanship which has taken up several main teams from Astana to build toward the concept of a common security community. As Minister Ažubalis this morning stated, it is essential that we pursue the resolution to protracted conflicts, that we cooperate and coordinate our efforts to address transnational threats. That first is and foremost, we protect human rights, strengthen democratic institutions, and ensure the electoral process and media freedom. All of these pose challenges to security and freedom if they remain unaddressed, not just for specific states, but for the entire Euro-Atlantic and Euro-Asian region. Security must be indivisible by geography and across all dimensions of society if it is to be true security. As I look at Europe, and I took further afield, I am struck that even events in North Africa, the Middle East, and even Japan have a message and a warning. And that warning is for us. Events in Japan have once again demonstrated that our efforts cannot only be directed at political and social problems. We must work together to protect ourselves from natural calamities and provide strong, meaningful environmental safety and security. Environmental threats know no boundaries and no barriers. They affect us all and call us to establish the highest level of environmental safety to preserve the security of our very lives and society. For years it was argued that the condition in the Arab world were different than in Europe, Eastern Europe in particular. It has long been argued that among Arab people there was an acceptance of strong central leadership and there was no great steering for democracy among the people. No one can credibly argue that about the Arab states today. And what about the OSCE region? In our realm, I do not foresee North African, Middle Eastern circumstances arising. I do sense, however, the same strong steering for greater expression of human rights, adherence to the rule of law, pluralistic society, media freedom and opportunities for free expressions, whether with Facebook and Twitter through the old-fashioned means of public assembly, the traditional media, and the electoral process. And as I indicated before, I sense the danger that some still seek to maintain so-called security by maintaining control through force, both within their own states and with respect to their neighbors. Today there is a serious need for democratic organizations, institutions and governments in the EU, OSCE, NATO, Council of Europe to work closely with the governments and leaders of societies seeking to undergo changes, to support transitions without upheaval or violence. The tools, the systems, the experience is there is in abundance to be shared, and it is a delicate and intricate process. It requires strong adherence to principles, but also careful listening to those undergoing the change. Our Euro-Atlantic and European security, our European security and freedom depends on it. Can we meet the challenge?